So this is the outline of my talk today. First of all, an introduction about multibody simulation. Next, some background information. Then I would like to show you some assemblies. So I would fill this talk, at least half of it, to show you some assemblies so that you get an impression what is in fact possible with this package in the end. This package is not in public already. It will be published maybe in September. And in the end, I will give you a short note of future work and some backup. Okay. Package name is MuboSym, which is says multi-body symbolic. So in fact, there are two different ways to approach this problem. You can use symbolic equations and you can stick more to the numerical side. Most of the industrial products stick to the numerical side, but we decided to approach it analytically. Our aim is to provide, on basis of existing Python packages, to provide once in a while a complete multi-body simulation tool. So why is this important for us? I mean, you can guess it. We want to be independent from market leaders. For example, Simpac, or also VL, or also Adams, costs a whole lot of money, the license, and all of these companies are now not, they are now, bought by very big companies, so it is not possible to stick in this development process. It's much easier. Second, scripting ability is included. Of course, it's in Python, so it's of course included. And third, educational purposes. So what is multi-body simulation? Multi-body simulation deals with systems which can be described by these equations. These are the Newtonian Euler equations. They are differential equations, so they are well known since several hundred years. What is the problem writing them down and integrating them? Well, the problem here is, as you will see in my talk, this F is not only an expression which you can write down. It happens that most of multi-body simulation assemblies include constraints, and constraints are like a ball which runs on a table or sliders or whatsoever. So these constraint forces are in fact the difficult thing in multi-body simulations. We look back at the development process of 30 years more or less, not us, but in general, so the community, the scientific community is working on this problem since more or less 30 years. And you can imagine there come up a whole tons of papers out of there, and and you cannot expect to climb up within half a year on top, but we are very enthusiastic and we think we can go ahead this way. So use cases of this multi-body simulation is mechanical engineering, ground vehicle dynamics, robotics and biomechanics. Each of these branches are more. Each of these branches is modern and relevant. So I'm working in ground vehicle dynamics since more or less 7 years, and I'm doing ride and handling simulation for another company right now. And I know what the difficulties are in this field. So what package are we using? SymPy is more or less the basis of this one. SymPy is these guys who produced SymPy, they were doing a really, really, really great job, And I would like to thank you, those people. It's a symbolic algebra package, so it replaces more or less these three products. And it's on a very, it's right at the moment, it's on an advanced level. So it's not that you can just do some algebra derivatives or integrals. It's on a high advanced level, and it also includes already advanced mechanics. So why do not puzzle these together, stick these loose ends together, and produce something which with which you can do your multi-body simulation. So fine, we tried to do this. I would like not to forget these packages which are really, really helpful and maybe the core of numerical and scientific Python programming, NumPy and SymPy. And without these, it would not happen anything about of this. For linear algebraic solvers, we use NumPy. They're very, very, very advanced. And not to forget, well tested. So these packages are so well tested that you can trust on this. And this is good. There are some ODE solvers in SymPy available. So in the end, we need some graphics. Graphics we did with VPython. VPython is a medium advanced. It's really, really nice, but it has some primitives, called primitives, some rods, springs, and so on. And you can put these together and make out of these your graphics simulation. In fact, you need this to make sure that your assembled equations behave well. So just a visual check of your solution. I mean, you cannot just solve your equations and then put some graphs, and then you cannot judge if this is done really nice or really good. You have some visual check up. Now some background theory. I will try to make this short. Building blocks of a mechanical system. You have your bodies. Every body has 6 degrees of freedom, translation, rotational. Including the time derivatives, you end up with 12 degrees of freedom. So each body should lead to 12 lines in your system of ordinary differential equations. If there wouldn't be some possibilities to boil it down somehow. Each of these bodies has mass and moments of inertia, intrinsic. So this is the figure citation. This is not mine. This is also not my figure, so I will cite it. You can boil down. You can boil down the numbers of degrees of freedom by joints. Joints you can think about as two bodies are connected via joints, like in your skeleton. And in fact, it's technically done more or less the same. Each of these joints can be produced in a technical sense. And in the end, with these joints, you reduce the numbers of degrees of freedom. Here we talk about these type of joints, cardanic, axis, revolute. For example, if you think about a tire on a car, it's just revolute, except that, okay, the front tire can also steer, but more or less revolute, so it's a revolute joint. In these equations appears forces and torques. Forces and torques accelerates your masses. So forces most of the time appear pairwise. So if one body is attracting another, it's the same done for the other body. So, but you have different types of forces. Pairwise forces. So think about sun and earth, for example. The external forces. If you just want to find a system of of a mechanical system on Earth, you would add the gravitational force, of course, and you wouldn't include the Earth as an independent mass, but you just would add your gravitational field as an kind of external force. And the difficult things, the constraint forces. For example, if you have here a surface and a ball is running on the surface would act a force on the ball to be on this surface. So in multibody simulation, you see many times these kind of drawings, because these kind of drawings show most of the things included. Here, for example, you have a chain of bodies, and here are the joints. And you can see if you switch from Cartesian coordinates to just the angle here, you can reduce it somehow, the number of degrees of freedom. Nobody would write this down in Cartesian coordinates, but in angles. But you know, if the generalized coordinates are minimal, it equals the number of degrees of freedom. But it is not always the case, so you can have more generalized coordinates, so you would have add on top of it some equations which gives you the constraints. Even the generalized coordinates are not unique. So you can, for example, measure the angle towards the set axis or towards the axis of the previous body. So it is not at all unique, the set of generalized coordinates. One problem, which is really maybe the main or the core, one of the core problems in multibody simulation, is this one. So if you have, this is called a constraint loop. If you do not just have your joints, but if you have another constraint in the end, which builds a constraint loop, you can say, okay, these angles here on top, they are somehow connected to each other. They cannot be independent at all. And this is called constraint loop, and this constraint loop produces another equation, most of the time an algebraic equation. And this algebraic equation you can take care of in, there are several possibilities to solve these kind of problems. Most of the time there are differential algebraic equation methods, but they are very costly, and in Python maybe too slow. So we propose here a solution according to Lagrange 1 with additional drawback force. For linearization, you can always put this algebraic equation into your set of equations. Here, this is the set of methods we can use to to generate our equations of motions. In this package, SymPy, they produced here already Kane's method, which is also called D'Alembert's principle of virtual work, and Lagrange's method number 2. Hamilton's equations is another possibility, but not used here. Okay, so I will show you how it is used. You just need to, if you are a user, you just need to have an object which set up your world. This gives you a world coordinate system and a marker. A marker is always a coordinate system in the language of multibody simulation. There are methods provided to add bodies and markers, so extra coordinate systems, external forces, extra constraints, and, for example, reflective walls. An ODE solver is connected more or less automatically. A 3D graphical backend is connected automatically. So each body signs up in the graphical backend and appears somehow as you want it to be appeared. I will show you examples later on. Some physical quantities are provided, like energy, forces, velocity, and so on. You can, if you, I mean, we are inside Python, so you can You can calculate whatever you want here, and this is the advantage. New and interesting. So what did we put into this work? We would like to have a completeness of joints and tools. And the Jacobian is calculated for linearization analysis. So this is on top, a nice feature, very nice feature. The linearization tool, which is already in SymPy, is kind of completed. We can detect automatically independent and dependent coordinates and so on. Constraints loop are more or less kind of solved here. External models and parameter span can be included. This is a very important point here, the external models, which I will show you in one example. Oh, we have also some B-splines, which can be used. If you don't have an analytical expression for your force, you can also include some kind of B-splines for having a representative of your force function. So sometimes measurements don't give you analytical expressions. Okay, coding style, set up the system. Here, this is your multi-body simulation world. You add your bodies, your markers, your forces, your force models, your external force model, your geometric constraint. Assembling and solving is it's just this one. Here you have maybe some constant, like the gravitational constant. You give it a number, you produce the equations of motion and integrate them. Post-processing is calculation of linear analysis, linearization, so stability analysis. You prepare and animate your result. Okay, if you would like to be a developer once in a time, or if you would like to work with SymPy once in a time, you should be aware of these three things. I mean, you should be aware of many things, but these three especially. Never use SymPy for numerics. Do not try to use, for example, to use SymPy to solve for eigenvectors. It will never happen. It will never be as fast as NumPy. So find the right step between SymPy to NumPy. Okay. So I got the sign for 10 minutes right now, so I will hurry a little bit up. Lambdify is one of the core functions of SymPy. I mean, if you have an algebraic expression, what can you do with it in a computer? You would like to use it as a function, and to use it as a function, you use this word, which is called lambdify. You lambdify expressions into Python functions, and this is really maybe the most impressive invention here. Not our, from SymPy. And ODE solvers, don't use your own. So even if it looks like fun to produce one, it is not never as good as those which are around. Use those. We use LSODR solver. Oh yeah, this is also a call for sundials. Maybe if you are interested in these topics, you know that sundials is an open source solver which is out there but not connected to Python at the moment. It is connected, but it stopped kind of at Python 2.6 or so. So I would like to connect this and use this sundial solvers, which is really good in my opinion. Okay, I will show you examples. And for these examples, not only the pictures, but also the results, so the movies. Oy. Let's try. Okay, this is bad because now it appears here on my screen and not on the screen I wanted it to be appeared. So this is what comes out more or less. This is a crank slide, something called crank slide. And this is a simple example for a constraint loop. Here, this goes round and round, and this goes linear. So this is rotating linear. You see, we put in also some forces, and here an extra constraint force. So this, if we don't put this constraint force here, it would be just a pendulum. So right now, I will give you another. So I will skip some of these because I have 12 and this is too much. Maybe this one. Some spring and it's a reflective wall here at this position. There's a reflective wall. It's interesting because it's not so fluent, but I don't know why, because it's in the middle of two screens maybe, yeah. So this is a reflective wall example. And I will show you this one. This is a simple car, and this is non-trivial. I mean, maybe you can see this, that assembling these equations takes around 60 seconds. Let's take a look at the assembly here. So these equations, they just come up by this mechanism. And this mechanism, as I told you, is quite easy. So we just add bodies, markers, special forces, and so on. And in the end, here, this is the steering, more or less. And in the end, here, this is the starting vector. So you need starting vectors. And in the end, we just call here canify, and then these equations are assembled. And now it's around 60 seconds assembling equations of motion. And why is this non-trivial? Because it is not only the mechanics, which you can see here, it's also kind of an external model. It's a tire model which we plugged in, and the tire model gives you, I mean, if you think about tires, I know, yeah, if you think about tires, it's a non-trivial external model. And I'm working in ground vehicle dynamics, so it matters a lot to plug in to your system non-trivial external models. And the nice thing here is that it is possible to do this. Now it's integrating. We have around 27 degrees of freedom, in fact, altogether. No, 28. So it's okay, it's fast. It's not real time at the moment, but it's fast, so it's not bad. I mean, if you would like to make it real time, you would have to export it in a C or Fortran code, then it would be real time, but at this level, it is not. But it's okay, hope so. Somehow it's a little bit slower, I don't know why, because maybe it's some resources here out. Yeah, I can tell you this, we used here a Pacheco model. Pacheco, maybe one of some of you may know this. Pacheco is a professor. He's working on tire models, and he's really, really famous on this in this area of research. And tires, they are quite interesting to model because it's rubber, and rubber is always difficult. So, for example, if you think about rolling tires or so, they sometimes include a no-slip constraint. But with tires, this would never work because tires produce the longitudinal and vertical force only with slip. So you have to include slip in your calculation. So now, here on top of this, we have calculated, in the end, the eigenvalues of the Jacobian. So you can see this. And now I will go into the animation. In this step, all of these degrees of freedom has to be prepared in Cartesian coordinates that it works. So now here, let's go. This is our car model. It looks simple, but it's okay. It is in fact more or less fixed on zero, so that it. This is a sine steering. It's a simple maneuver, sine steering. But it's nice that it's working well. You can see it's breaking in the end here on top. I can show you just this. We have also some outputs calculated for the tires, special values for the tires, and put these into these graphs. Okay, so I would skip the examples and go to some future work. This is not so easy. Yeah, okay. We thought about make the assembly equations persistent. This is non-trivial because the assemblies are not, they are quite complex objects. So ZODB, which I really like, but it's based on serialization, and very complex objects cannot be serialized this way. And I would like to do this to make it persistent, because to skip the assembly, which may take a little bit of time. So graphics, always some improvements to be done, model validation, and just-in-time compilation is another nice idea to speed up. Post-processing with pandas, maybe you know this package. Okay, so future work. Complete the basics until September and full vehicle simulation. So to end up with a nice full vehicle simulation, better than that one I showed to you, October until December 2015. And thank you for your attention. And I would like to invite you to ask questions. Thank you very much.
You talked about transitioning from SymPy to NumPy to do numerical compilations, computations. Is there an automated path from SymPy to NumPy, perhaps?
At the moment, I'm not aware that they are closely connected. And this is a kind of a pitfall. I think you have to, except for this LambdaFi, you need sometimes, if you plug your numbers in, just convert your SymPy matrices to NumPy matrices one by one. This is how I did it, and this works fine.
Thanks.
Okay.
That's all the time we've got, so let's have another round.
Thank you. Thank you very much.